We are having trouble once again with our projector, with all the different units flip-flopping back and forth, and it's just scripture slides. I'm just going to read them to you, if that's all right with you. One of the things that several years back, I guess it's been actually 18 years, I was figuring it up. I've been here 21 years, 3 years into my pastorate here. I had a young man who came into my office, and he said he was getting ready to marry a young gal, and I was doing some counseling, and the family was having just a ton of trouble with some of his views. And so they asked me, would you just talk to this kid? I said, sure, I'll be glad to talk to him. I don't even remember his name at this point. But here was my first experience with this, as I sat in the office, and he began to describe this story about his dad having been abducted by aliens in a UFO. Now, I'm a Southern Baptist pastor. I've been educated in one of the most stringent conservative venues that are available. And there I was listening to this, and in my brain I'm going, I've got nothing. Lord, could you help me? What do I do with this young individual? And I don't know exactly what I said. I wasn't unkind to him. I just knew he believed what he believed, and it was an interesting story. But that perched in the back of my head, and we went out to, some years later, it was not too long, maybe 2-3 years later, we went out to Roswell, and it was at a UFO abduction symposium. And I sat in the back, and my wife and I went, and we sat in the back, because we knew the Lord had sent us there. Didn't have a clue why we were responding in obedience. And she and I sat in the very back row. And the reason why we sat in the back row is because there wasn't a row any further back to sit. I literally had my head up against the wall, and I'm looking around, and I'm thinking to myself, man, there be freaks in this room. I just was looking for the tinfoil hats. And here's something that really astonished me, was that Joe Jordan, who I've since stopped really following, but at that time I had some things he had very interesting, and I think this day was great in this. He said he discovered something along his walk with the Lord as a MUFON, which is Mutual UFO Observer. And he said that in his quest, he began to ask the Lord, Lord, you know, I believe your Bible has the answers. What are the answers for UFO abduction? What do I tell these people? And the Lord replied, I've already given you what you need. Don't you just hate it when the Lord does something like that? In other words, let me translate it for you. Dig, boy. And he went back and watched over 1,000 hours of film that they had taken of these interviews. And here's the key. He said, in one of those, a lady had become a Christian after a UFO abduction. And she said, when she cried out to the Lord Jesus, the heads of these critters, whatever they are, Roswell Grays, Nordics, I don't know, they responded, and she was immediately back where she was. Now, I don't know what all that means, but I've spent the last close to 2 decades trying to find out. Now, I want to explain something to you today. That what's interesting is in that same symposium, I had gone there basically because they had talked about Nephilim the year before. I'd seen the disc set. Jared had bought it from Mike Malone? Guy Malone. And I was quite fascinated with it, and they got into the subject of Nephilim. And I was at a table with Robert Hyde, who was behind the scenes and promoting some things in radio, and Tom Bionic, I don't know if you know him. We were sitting at a lunch, and I mentioned the word Nephilim, and Tom got up, acted kind of weird, and said he dismissed himself and walked off, and it kind of left a bad taste in my mouth. But I began to understand right then that there was a serious division in the community now that had broken loose over the subject of Nephilim. And that's something I don't understand why. Because if we seek the truth of a position, the Proverbs say, a fool doesn't care whether he understands a matter or not, as long as he gets his point across. I don't want to be a fool. I'm not interested in clobbering Judd with my brilliance and convincing him of a position. And I tell you, Judd's not interested in that with me either. And Rob, what we're interested in is discovering the truth. Wherever it is, that's what we want to know. Because when we search for the truth instead of trying to defend a particular position, we can never be defeated in our cause. If Judd or Rob or Jared or Joe or Aaron come up with a better position, I'm glad to adopt it. And I am stronger for it. And what truly bothers me in our community today is are these rifts and divisions opening up. Because we've got our egos in place. The Bible tells us to accept one another on disputable matters. You know, today there's a huge debate over flat earth going on the internet. Oh my God, that's the third rail. Don't touch that! Well, why not? Why not look at it? If you don't like it, dismiss it. If you do like it, good for you. What does it matter? But some years ago, like I say, it's been close to two decades, and it's farther back than that, I was sitting in a class with a man by the name of Wayne Grudem. Wayne Grudem is a systematic theology brainiac. He has his own systematic theology manual. Not very tall, rather diminutive statured man, but has a brain that is like 100 Crane supercomputers hooked together. And I had the privilege of sitting with him in some classes where he absolutely destroyed some theological positions that I held. And I walked out of the class and I said, I can't possibly be that position anymore. I've got to change. One of them was cessation of the miraculous gifts. But here's the funny part about Wayne is I mentioned Nephilim in his class. Now there's a surface reading to it in Genesis 6, if you ask me. It's pretty straightforward. And Wayne is the biggest brain I know, a wonderful man, true man of God, one of my greatest mentors ever. I have nothing bad to say about Wayne. But when I mentioned the Nephilim, he went to the Sons of Seth theory. And I was astonished that this incredible intellect had, that he could get drawn that conclusion. And I said to myself, you really haven't thought about this much, have you, Wayne? Well, thanks to the men in this room and others like us on the internet, we're looking hard at it. Genesis 6 talks about the Nephilim were on the earth in those days. You can translate that earthborn. You can translate that fallen ones. There's kind of a erroneous translation, but actually is true. The giants were on the earth in those days. The Bible tells us this. Let me explain something to you. I am a Bible junkie without apology. I am not interested in looking cool to the world. I am interested in being aligned with the truth of God without apology. One of the greatest mistakes preachers have made in our day, if we have become civilized. Let me explain something to you. I am not civilized without apology. You put me in a room with some of these idiot politicians who are pumping up this stuff today, and they're going to launch me, baby, because I'm just going to tell them where the mop flops. Why? Because the truth is really all that matters. Amen. Now, the scriptures tell us to present it seasoned with grace. I got it. Working at it. Not, don't always get it right, but working at it. You know, but it says they were on the earth in those days. I get it, Lord. I believe it. It says they were on the earth also afterwards. Okay, what does that mean? We have these multiple incursion theories and what Rob presented. Let me present this to the whole academic community. My Bible says they were there also afterwards. I don't give a flying flip how it happened, other than in passing conversation and discussing. I just understand that they were there. I accept that because the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Amen. And Billy Graham said, The Bible says it, I believe it, that does it. Billy, it doesn't matter whether you believe it or not. If the Bible says it, that does it. God's opinion rules. I'm a preacher first and foremost, most unapologetically. So let's look at the subject of Nephilim. Let's look at the subject of giants. Let's look at the subject of fallen ones. It says there were the mighty men of old. That, you know, they came in, bore sons to the daughters of men. They bore children to them. They were mighty men of old. They were men of renown, the Gilgamesh, Nimrod, whatever name you want to call them. They were those dudes that we read about in Judge studies and I've looked at in ancient Near East history classes. And here's the problem, is the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was on evil continually, only evil continually. The Nephilim presence on our earth is disastrous. It's completely wrong. And any time their presence begins to manifest itself, we got troubles. Daniel 2:43 says, it talks about at the end, you know, you've got this big statue and you've got a head of gold. That's Nebi. And you've got the chest of silver and the belly of bronze and the legs of iron. And then you get down to the iron and miry clay. Missler blew my mind one time. I used to wonder, I've sat wondering, is that communism? Is that, what is that? What does that mean? Miry clay and iron mixed together? I don't get it. Read the text, Daniel 2:43. It says, they shall mingle their seed. In some translations, co-mingle their seed with the seed of men. Whoa, what are you saying? Now, we're all adults here, right? Men and women co-mingle all the time. It's not noteworthy. It's part of life. But the Bible spends an entire sentence to record this fact. And it says, they shall co-mingle their seed with the seed of men. Who's they? The end empire. The scriptures attest to it. Are something that are not completely man. Do you get it? Are we in the end of times or are we not? I believe we are. But that's another subject. But this wickedness that's pervasive today, this, even Mike Heiser's been on this subject, and you know, I'm with Jared. There are a lot of things I agree with Mike. There's some things I'm kind of getting a little bit irritated with, but I accept him as a brother and we're going to argue this stuff out. But he's talking about how the Israelites ascribed the evil that was in the world to the Nephilim incursion. They blamed it on them. It seems to me maybe Scripture does too, when the goat named Azazel that Jared pointed out. And by the way, all this black arts and all that kind of stuff and sacrifice of children, these occultists are feeding an energetic disembodied spirit called this, a demon. No, it's actually a Nephilim spirit according to ancient beliefs. Energetic beings, spiritual beings feed on energy, spiritual energy. They love fear. Why does every angel, when you see him in the scripture, go, fear not? And they feed on disinformation, which is why Jesus always said, truly, truly, I say unto you, if you're King James fanatic, verily, verily, I say unto you. So the incursion of these Nephilim is antithetical and completely 180 degrees out of phase with what God would require of the human race. We are sheep as believers. They are predators. They are wolves. We are made in the image of God. They are made in the image of something not God. And thus began the ancient struggle of old. The Nephilim Strategem. This projector, for some reason, decided not to work with my computer good. I don't like it anyway. But the Nephilim stratagem, the great deception. Stratagem is an artifice or a trick in war for deceiving, outwitting the enemy. We saw that, well, not us, we see it on documentaries. You know, the great works of the Allies when Patton, they formed a fake army around them in England. Radio transmissions and fake divisions, and Hitler was planning for a big invasion at Calais, and Rommel was the smart ones going, I don't think so, Bubba. And Hitler was wrong, and Rommel was right, and we got a toehold because of our stratagem, our trick, our outwitting. Satan is top of the line deceiver and is doing everything that he can to do that. General Schwarzkopf in Desert Storm. Saddam had all of his forces arrayed and thought, man, we're just going to chew these guys up. Schwarzkopf said, I don't think so. We're going to hit you where you ain't. And he got around behind him. Great stratagem. What is the Nephilim stratagem? What is this? How does this negative energy manifest? What is it that's so antithetical? That they're the antithesis and the destructing force, the corrupting force of those that God calls his people. John 8:44 says, You are of your father the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. You know, we have this statement in our culture, well, it's just a white lie. I don't think God thinks that way. I'm just saying. You see, because every time he hears us lie, he hears this maniacal force out there called Satan speaking through us, because Satan is the father of all lies. This is their mother tongue, their native language. When you get into deliverance, you know, I've had people, hey, what, did you ask the demon questions? And it's like, no. Why? Why would I want to ask a person who, an individual, a non-bodied person, a disembodied person, whatever these things are, why would I want to know their opinion on anything? Because they're trying to trick me. Jesus knew that. He said, be quiet. Come out of him. Shut up. Because they're liars. If you look at that in that capacity, what do you think Washington's born of? Have you heard really any truth lately out of that joint? It's disgusting. It really is disgusting. Now, Jared was talking about this condition that's out there, this phenomenon that was out there, this occultism that's sacrificing these children. You know, the scriptures are plain. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood, Ephesians 6. You all know this passage. But against the rulers and the authorities, against the cosmic powers, over this present darkness, over the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. We could go through the cosmic craton and the archon, and all, we could do that, but just trust me, they're stacked up hierarchically. There are ones, in charge of regions, in charge of whatevers. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that they may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand there, therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth and having put on the breastplate of righteousness. Do you realize that the belt of truth was that which locked all other pieces of the armor together? And it is still the same today. Why is it important to live in the truth? It's because if we don't live in the truth, our armor dismantles itself and we're not guarded. Shield of faith, fiery darts, extinguishing themselves, I believe. But wearing the armor of God requires, at the center of it, the truth. This great deception that's coming upon us. Matthew 24:24. For false Christs and prophets will arise and perform great signs and wonders so as to lead astray, even if possible, the elect. Any elect out there? That statement gets my attention because I'm in that number. And this is my Lord, my God, telling me that if it's possible, I could be deceived. How is that? I live, and if need be, die for the truth. I don't like to be lied to, and I don't like to be deceived. So I can tell you right now, you deceive me in my life someplace, in business or this church, then you're going to have something hanging over your head for a long time with me. You're going to, you break that trust and you got problems with me. Come up, tell me to my face you don't like me. I respect that. I hate lies. And I think it's because Jesus himself hates lies. But we live in a world that's permeated and overrun with lies. You've been lied to since the day you were born, and most of us don't quite get it. William Casey, CIA director, 1981. William Casey, CIA director, 1981, said this: "We'll know our disinformation program is complete when everything the American public believes is false." Really? You mean at the very heart of your thought process is you want to deceive absolutely everyone in the American public? Because why? You're of your father, the devil. Now, let's go back to Daniel 2:43 in our heads. And it says, "And they shall commingle their seed with the seed of men." And I think there are two ways you can create a Nephilim in this world. Think of it as computers with operating systems. If a person gives himself over, something Malachi Martin, a Reformed Jesuit priest, said one time that got my attention. He said, "There's such a thing as perfect possession. In the Bible, we see examples of people being possessed. They thrash around. They're fighting this demonic programming, and they want it gone." But in our world today, and Jared is hot on the trail of this stuff all the time. Russ Dizdar is in the middle of it. In our world, there is this system, this cosmos, this world order, these kratons and archons that are seeking interface with the world. This is what they require of us, is our worship. Jesus was confronted by Satan at a high place that he took him to. "I will give you all these things if you just bow down and worship me." And Skiba, I wonder if it is on that disappearing mountain in the North Pole. I don't know. That was a curious thought. You'll have to listen to that broadcast. Jesus did not rebuke Satan for the offer. He just said, "Get behind me." We'll know our disinformation program is complete when everything the American public believes is false. This perfect possession, people giving themselves over to it. And in Daniel 2:43, what it says is, right after that it says, "And in the days of those kings." I think what that means today, this Nephilim stratagem, whether you're putting someone with a demonic program in a human body, you have a Nephilim. They're doing the same work. Or we have a hybrid program, I believe you can get the same results both ways. Truthfully, I believe today we have both. I can't vet that. I've never captured any black-eyed children. I don't have any Roswell Grays caged. No one's ever came up to me and said, "Yeah, I'm a Nephilim." I've just never had that. But I do believe they're there, and I believe there are a lot of people on track for that. I believe our military is sponsoring that. I believe the scriptures attest to that. But we have, at the very height of our society, a group of people who are working against this, and they have been in the background. William Cooper spoke about a secret priesthood that worked in behind the scenes. William Cooper, William C. Cooper of, Behold the Pale Horse fame, Veritas Radio, a CAGI organization, has always been under this. He's dead now. He's been dead for probably 12 years. You start looking back, the first Earl of Chatham spoke of the English throne. He said, "There's a power behind the throne that's more powerful than the throne." There was a man in the White House back during the Franklin Delano Roosevelt days, I believe. I'm pulling from memory. And he said, "There's something here that's so powerful, interlocked, secretive, that we don't dare speak of it above whispered tones." There is this secret priesthood, and I believe that it's this Nephilim influence, either through demonic possession and people who have sold their souls for power, or hybrids, or both. There's some type of angelic interface with the sons of God that Judd has done such a great job showing us. Our own country is full of relics and full of history of large Nephilim giants. My church has two people in it that come from one from the Comanche culture and the other one from the Mexican version of the Hopi culture, Tatawata or something. I can't even pronounce the name. Tatamata, is that what it is? All right, thank you. They have memories in their tribes of the giants and what they did. It is indisputable in my mind. Judd pointed out something that just blew my mind. about the Lewis and Clark expedition, and it was Meriwether Lewis, was it? Yeah, was killed. Committed suicide, you know, shot himself in the head twice and in the back once and cut his own throat. You know, that's called Arkanside, you know. To keep the secret of the Nephilim safe that they were here. And why would anyone seek to cover that up? Because I believe they mingle with us. Call me nuts if you want to. I really don't care. That's how I read my Bible. Now, I want you to see something. In a culture like ours, Understanding Media, the Extensions of Man by Marshall McLuhan. I want you to see something. In a culture like ours, long accustomed to splitting and dividing all things as a means of control, it is sometimes a bit of a shock to be reminded that, in operational and practical fact, the medium is a message. I have spent 15 years of my life trying to understand what he meant with that. 15 years of my life pondering that, sitting at my study desk or riding my, I'm bivocational, I have a tractor business, riding my tractor, listening to podcasts and Skiba and Jed Burton and everybody under the sun and trying to gather as much information, and this came across and it's like, what do you mean the medium is the message? I can tell you right now, I've come to understand it. Because what our masters and the overlords of our society have decided to do is, this is the Nephilim stratagem, is to invert reality before us with the use of pseudoscience, very large budgets, and to create disunity among the believers. That is the Nephilim stratagem. It's the thing that if they can keep us divided and if they can keep us misinformed, they win. It's an amazing thing. Now how does that work? How does the medium become the message? I'm a Bible guy. I'm fixing to either turn your switch off or you're going to go, holy moly, what the heck just happened? Because it happened to me. I seek the truth. I am willing to go wherever it leads. I'm not afraid of the shame. Athanasius, one of my favorite old-timers in the church, they told him, Athanasius, the whole world is against you. I love his reply. And he says, then Athanasius is against the whole world. What a spunky little dude, huh? Amen? Athanasius, bring it! You gotta love a dude like that. He'd probably be impossible to live with, but so am I. Thank you, Randy. You've been talking to my wife. You've been plowing with my heifer again, haven't you? But I say to you, do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Now, I can tell you that I've always just taken that, okay, God's a big dude, and he's just talking about, he could kick his feet out on the earth if he wanted to, right? Skiba, right? Jared, right? Judd, right? I mean, hey, you know, it's phenomenological language. No, that wouldn't be phenomenological. That's just figurative. Figurative language. The sun raced across the sky. That's phenomenological. The earth is a footstool. You know, we're going to interpret it literally, but it's figurative. Duh. What does it mean that the earth is a footstool for his feet? Well, that leads me to a whole different set of it. Of the medium is a message. Now let's look at Genesis 1:6. Let's look at the truth of Scripture arrayed against what we have been taught. I'm trying to tell you that we are living under a tremendous misinformation campaign. William Casey said so, and a lot of other people have too, if you just don't have time for that presentation. And God said, let there be an expanse in the midst of the water. Let it separate the water from the waters. And God made the expanse and separated the waters and that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. Amen. Preset 100. I've translated it in Bible school. And committed one of the biggest hermeneutical errors you can possibly make. It was of the highest order. Because I allowed NASA to dictate to me what I believed. I was looking in my head, okay, here's the model they taught us of the earth. And I started looking at the spherical blob of water hanging in space. And there was a lot of stuff I put on. And then in the midst of this, all these debates that are going on the internet, I begin to look at it. And let me give you the conclusion. I don't know what I believe, but let me show you something I've found in Scripture. Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters. That word there, expanse, can be translated firmament. That word firmament comes from a Hebrew word, rock, which is it's rakia in this particular passage. You know, we've been taught since the beginning. If you look at William Casey, he says everything we believe will be wrong. We've been taught since the beginning that there's this big open space above us and it goes off into the vacuum of nothingness. But I can tell you that is not what that word says. And if I apply the same rigorous hermeneutical hygiene and pattern to my life and seeking the truth, I sat there looking at that and I went, what? How does that work? That's hard to swallow. I went to the ice canopy theory that creationists have been flaunting and it disappeared during the flood and all that. And yeah, maybe. I don't know. Let's go look and see if there's anything else in Scripture. That you go to Exodus 24, where the Mosaic covenant that is reaffirmed. Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 elders of Israel went up and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. The earth is the footstool of his feet. And we see a portion of God, or the Israelites do, and his feet are upon a pavement that looks like the sky. Is that the Rakia? Well, that's interesting, but, you know, come on, Dan. Surely not. Let me find another passage and look at it from a perspective that is ruthlessly, hermeneutically, hygienically clean. Looking at it from a passage of Scripture, not importing what NASA or anybody on this stinking planet has tried to convince us of. Ezekiel 1, 22 through 26. Over the heads of the living creatures, there was a likeness of a firmament? An expanse? That's rakia there. That's the same Hebrew word. Now let me explain something to you. Rakia doesn't mean expanse. Rakia means like a metalsmith beating out a pan of metal. It doesn't talk about space. And if this is true, and Scripture seems at this point, I'll tell you, I haven't made a conclusion. I'm just taking you down the rabbit hole with me, man. The likeness of the expanse, shining like awe-inspiring crystals spread out over their heads. And under the firmament, their wings were stretched out straight, one towards another. And each creature had two wings covering its body. And when they went, I heard the sound of their wings like the sound of many waters, like the sound of the Almighty, and a sound of tumult, like the sound of an army. When they stood still, they let down their wings, and there came a voice from above the firmament over their heads. It appears you got something flying under the firmament, and the voice that's speaking is up there on top of the firmament. And when they stood still, they let down their wings, and above the expanse over their heads was the likeness of a throne, in the appearance like sapphire. Let me put this in. Azure blue, like the sky. And above the expanse over their heads was the likeness of a throne, in appearance like sapphire. And seated above the likeness of a throne was a likeness with a human appearance. Wait a minute. Back up. God said, the earth is a footstool of his feet. Let me give you another tidbit. Isaac Newton, I believe it was, said that there would come a day, and he was more theologian than he was scientist. He wrote 500,000 words of science. He wrote 1,000,000 in theology. Quite a theologian. And created the discipline of science for the purpose of finding the repeatability of the created order and discover the nature of his God. A Christian chasing his God in truth. Amen? And above the expanse over their heads, there was a likeness of a throne in appearance like sapphire. And seated above the likeness of the throne was a likeness with human appearance. Could it be true that God's word is literal? And that when he says the earth is a footstool of his feet, you could somewhere up there on some type of crystalline dome, or perhaps firmed up water with some type of technology we don't understand, you see it. I don't know. What do you think? Let's chase it some more. It said to separate the waters that were above from the waters that were below. What does that mean? Let's look to the Bible for some clarity. And now understand, I am not trying to convince you of any single position. I'm trying to tell you that we have been lied to at every level. And the only hope we have of getting out of this rat hole is to be hermeneutically, hygienically pure and look to our scriptures to give us our answers for anything in life. Our definition of love is not lust. Look to 1 Corinthians 13. Luke 11. Let's look. Is water perhaps the native environment of heaven then? How would that track? Return of an unclean spirit. When the unclean spirit has gone out of a person, it passes through waterless places seeking rest and finding none, it says, I will return to my house from which I came. Why does it bother a spirit to go walking in waterless places? Has that ever plagued you? It has me. What if heaven is a liquid? And I'm saying what if. I'm not saying it is. I'm saying what if heaven is a liquid environment? Is that a piece of the puzzle we can drop in and add resolution? Because a Nephilim stratagem is the division of the church and the misinformation of all humankind. Because if we truly grasp the wonder of our creation, we would understand the greatness of our God. And that is something that these lying, know-nothing doofuses we call Nephilim seek to do to us. So what do we do? What's our cure? Let me give you another scripture real quick. The pigs. You ever wonder why the pigs ran to water? I don't know. It's one of those passages that plagues me. Ephesians 4:14 says, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine. I submit to you that we've been victims of human doctrine. Or by human cunning. I submit to you that we've been victims of human cunning. By craftiness and deceitful schemes. The devil has got scheme upon scheme upon scheme upon scheme. And I just want to say, he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists. He gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain, what's this? To the unity of the faith. God calls us to be unified, not divided. That's why when Rob Skiba and I have a difference, I accept Rob Skiba, and I hope he accepts me. That's why I don't think we have any differences, but if I ever have a difference with Judd, we're going to sit, we're going to throw that idea up on the table, and we're going to hack it to death, and I'm going to shove it over this way and say, take that, Judd! And he's going to go, I will, and he's going to make sushi out of it, and he's going to send it back to me and say, what do you think of that? And we're going to get up and go, man, that was a great discussion, wasn't it? Yeah, we learned a few things. You know, we hashed it out. We've come closer. Or we're going to get up and go, I love you, man, but you're crazy. That just can't fly. But I love you anyway. Because our first call in church is to unity. Unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And I can tell you that if we do this, not only do we move against the Nephilim stratagem, we defeat them entirely. And because their advance in our society is so putrid, when you look today, everything that I see are Nephilim foot tracks everywhere. Demonically possessed people. The type of Super Bowl rituals they're having. And just sex magic out in the open. And things going on. And if you were to read Malachi Martin's book, The Windswept House, you'd find that there was a ceremony in the Vatican. At the same time, there was one, I believe it was in Georgia, and they did human sacrifice together as a binding ceremony and to release demonic energy. Don't mean to bother any Catholics, but plenty of Baptists are out there doing this kind of garbage too. That's just a good example. God is calling us as people to pray for revival, because the only thing that will ever defeat this energy that we're up against is the Holy Spirit and our pursuit of ruthless pursuit of truth. Amen. Questions? Brains fried? All right. Amen. Randy.
So when are you going to start your YouTube channel?
I ain't starting a YouTube channel. Yeah.
So you're talking about the relentless, ruthless pursuit of truth.
Yes.
I absolutely agree. But why not use their medium to put the truth out too?
But say that last part again. I didn't understand.
Why not use their medium to get the truth out also? The medium's the message. Why not turn their whole paradigm around? Rob's doing it. A lot of other people are doing it.
Rob's better at taking flack than I am.
Well, it's something I think you would have to be called to. You know, right now, you're called to pastor a church, and it's a smallish church, and you're organizing these things, but you're also bivocational, working a second full-time job. And
my calling has always been to the church, to my family first. And the raising of two sons and caring for a wife and a beloved dog, Pumpkin. And my second calling has been to my church. And anything that detracts from that is, I'll pray about it. I'll pray about it. Josh.
I've been seeing a lot of things like on Facebook and YouTube about these giants that people are seeing in all these foreign places and on mountain ranges and everything like that. Do you think, which, I mean, I've known you for a while now, but do you think that it's going to slowly, but more and more of these occurrences starting to come to light in the media, or do you think it's still just going to be in the, like little YouTube channels and short little things like that?
I think that Nephilim and what they call mountain giants, or Sasquatch and what they call mountain giants, are definitely related to Nephilim. Now, what exactly they are, to tell you the truth, I don't want to examine any of them unless they've been run over on the road. I just don't want to go hunting them. And I think that there's evidence that they're transdimensional, multidimensional. Having said that, I can't bet that. I'm just speculating. And I think that, yes, we're going to see more and more. I think the Nephilim Strategem, okay, medium is a message. Thank you for that segue. We're seeing movie after movie, and Rob does a great job on Truman Show. Kudos. Great job. Took me to school on that one. That got my attention. I'd watched that a long time ago. But the medium is a message. See, what they do is they present these movies to us. For instance, like I was talking about the Rakia. People want to run to flat earth, and that's not what I'm about. I don't know what I am. I just don't have questions, and that's the truth. I think you have to address flat earth problems if you have a Rakia, but I'm looking strictly at I'm going at a biblical theology issue. I'm looking at one particular subject, trying to track it. Everything else is not important. But Let's get off track a little bit. In 1947, Bird went to the Antarctic. And it was 58 when things really began to get on a roll, but I didn't believe they started in 47. Because Bird came back, and they did a study in 47 on population control. In 57, there was a group out of Huntsville, Alabama, scientists that did a population growth control study. And 1967, I believe it was, a Club of Rome. I'm pulling everything from memory. So if you got out there on YouTube, it's wrong. Sorry, look it up. But I believe that they discovered something immensely different about the world than they thought. I think they ran into the Rakia, personally. That's my suspicion. Can I prove it? I would love to walk out there. And I would love to go to the Arctic and do an Arctic exploration. I don't care about the dangers. It'd be worth it to go bump the Rakia, you know. I'd love to do that. But saying that happened, everything changed in the media at that point. I want you to see this stratagem. I want you to see this artful deception. They began to make all these shows about outer space and create something. I believe they built a false universe that's just not there. And I believe that they began to pump this stuff into our heads. The medium was the message because it was shows about outer space. Today, we're being prepared to meet Nephilim as extraterrestrial because these things got no place else to go but here. And one of these days, they're going to impose themselves and their existence on ours. And because of that, they don't want us discovering the biblical truth that they're completely evil and need to be eradicated on sight. Is that they're seeking through Hollywood, which, look up Hollywood, it's a wizard's wand type stuff. Man, you want a deep subject, just start getting off on that stuff. But what we've seen are nothing but a barrage of space shows and flying saucers and outer space and planets and Star Trek and, oh my gosh, see, they're convincing us that there's something that there's not. And one of them, it's just incredible that we've bought into this, but yet, in my opinion, unless there's something I'm missing, and if there is, please bring it to me. I'm not afraid of the truth. There is something solid above us, and it's not space, man. It's a Rakia. And until someone shows me my definition of that word is wrong, which, frankly, I would love to be wrong on this subject. I don't want to be right on half the stuff I'm right on, but I know I'm right. But I will never surrender the truth and the pursuit of it to make anybody happy or to get people, you know, in love with me. And God bless dummies like Rob Skiba, who would be willing to take the beating that he does for just discussing the matter. It's crazy. Who else?
Joe had one before.
Joe.
Who was that quote from? CIA?
William Casey, 1981. Yes. But what funky moron sets out to deceive the entire world?
Satan.
You think about it. How long would I last? Not long in this church, let me tell you. If I stood up and said, my entire policy from this day forward will be to lead you to complete deception. They'd ask me to leave, step outside, and they would begin the prayer session for me. And I would have it coming. Stan.
Okay, on the Rakia, you already mentioned things that you've been, in looking at this, familiar with some of the standard creation models. You know, vapor canopy or ice crystals or whatever it is. From what you've done so far, would you consider, it seems kind of briefly alluded to this, but do you consider the possibility that what the nature of the Rakia or whatever had changed after God had cursed the earth after the flood?
I don't think so. 1 Peter 3:5, is it 3:5 or 3:15? It's in chapter 3. It says that long ago, they've forgotten that long ago the earth was formed out of water and by water.
Yeah.
All right. And in one translation or two, when you get into Greek, it talks about was compacted out of water. And so the earth was compacted out of water. Maybe it was minerals or something that God congealed from it. But in my opinion, it might have more of a meaning of some type of water technology of which we're not aware. Now, here's the funny part. Go looking in the world for evidence of the Rakia, right? I talked about scripture because that's where my strengths are. But I also am pretty good on the internet and looking for stuff. You know, the Russians tried to drill a deep hole, and they got 12 kilometers. I think it's, 9 miles? Hit something so hard they couldn't punch it. They spent years trying to drill in deeper.
Yeah.
10?
What's
that, 10 miles? Yeah, I mean, they hit something that just busted everything and sent down the hole. Rakia? But I can tell you one thing. The earth is not a molten core, according to the Russians. And you know something? Remember on the channel, the Trinity News and all that, they had this story about, they discovered hell, the Russians drilled the hole, there was this green luminous being came up out of it. And I don't know that I disbelieve that anymore, because the scriptures seem to indicate that there's something down there. A holding tank for disembodied spirits. Is that true? I don't know. Now here, this is something we hit on last year, and Rob put it out there on the internet. Okay, you go looking at the world. I looked at this Rakia thing, and it's like, I got to say, it blew my mind. It's like, I can't believe this. So I went looking. You know, Operation Fishbowl and Operation Dominic were, was it 58 they were done? Or was it
right after 58.
Right after 58.
They started it.
Yeah, I didn't come prepared to talk about this, but they started launching thermonuclear bombs into the air. That always bothered me. Why would you launch radioactive whatever into the air where it could just get all over everybody?
Both the United States and Russia.
Yeah, they were thumping something. They were blowing stuff up there. And they finally quit. You stop and think about it. Operation Fishbowl and Dominic. I said, okay, Fishbowl, that's easy. And I, Dominic, meaning of Dominic, Latin for of our master. Man, that was a mind blower. It was like, man, Skiba's smart, because when I mentioned it, he goes, what? Huh? What? You're kidding. It's just a mind blower. So we got a big bowl turned upside down on us, and we start launching nukes at it. Who's thinking this through anyway? Seriously. You got a primordial ocean on top of you, so you try to punch the fishbowl? I don't know. I'm just telling you what I found. And the point I'm trying to make in this particular study is that we are being deceived on more levels than we can understand. This is a deception that's thousands of years old. Somebody have their hand up. Is it Chris?
Yeah. This thought came to me a few minutes. Two thoughts came to me a few minutes ago. You talked about Operation Fishbowl and Operation Dominic before, I think on Wednesdays. And this also kind of goes in with what Sam was mentioning one time, where, they're trying to punch holes, maybe they're trying to get back that liquid environment.
I don't know. Yeah, that's a good thought. See, now, yeah, I'm sorry, you got my brain churning on that one, but I had a thought and it disappeared. Oh, in my statement that this Nephilim stratagem is to create a complete inversion of reality, is it so hard to believe? We have had a false religion stuffed down our guts since Charles Darwin.
Yep.
What does the Bible say? And God created man. Now, I want you to understand the profundity of this. What we are being taught is that matter, something gave rise to matter, coincidence, the Big Bang, there was absolutely nothing, and then it exploded. I mean, I don't get that. That's a Chuck Missler thing. But matter gave form to thought. Okay? But how does that really work? God had a thought and gave form to matter. What I'm telling you is evolution is a complete 180-degree upside-down inversion of reality. Is it so hard to believe? Like population control today. Do you know that they scream up and down that we have... They've been saying this since the 1700s. The English were trying to control population. They're getting it done today, though. But what's really interesting is that I've heard studies done that you could put everyone in the world in Texas... Give them a small house and a plot of ground for a garden, and they exist comfortably. Now, I've got to tell you, I'm thinking maybe population control is probably a lie. How about you, Skiba?
Yeah, big time.
What we're looking at is a complete disinformation program. Now, let's shift gears go to Bohemian Grove. The Molechian Mole, I'll give Jared that word, he loves it. Molechian owl, the owl that is the Molech. It has eyes that see in the dark. This is the illuminist plan. So what you have is a group of people who are seeking to keep us in the dark where they can see. That's the symbology behind the owl. Uh-oh, I see the shepherd staff coming. So we're ready to go? Anything you care to say?
I'm just coaxing.
You just what?
I'm just coaxing.
Coaxing, okay. Any other questions? Let's dismiss in prayer. And Joe Taylor, do you mind dismissing us in prayer, sir?
Heavenly Father, we're thankful today to come together with our friends of like mind and those that have other things for us to think about. Lord, we pray we might test all these things by the Word of God, which is which stands secure, as we know your throne does. We know that your love for us is secure. Help us remember that among all these things, Lord, that evil men have done on the earth and intend to do more, and that the fallen angels have brought wickedness upon the earth. We turn our eyes always to thee, O Lord, the love of Christ, the love of God that created the world and also sent the Savior of man at the appointed time who will come again for his people. We thank you, Lord, we have in the midst of all these trying times and these confusing things, we know that your love is secure for us. Help us remember that, Lord, and above all things, to share the love of Christ with others, that we might show in this world that there is hope, in the hope of Jesus Christ. We thank you for this ministry here. Help us, Lord, to always turn our eyes to the truth, which is in Jesus Christ. That's in his holy name we pray.
And before we go, our folks, if you've got, not visitors, but we've got some resetting and stuff to do for tomorrow, it'd be great if we could get many hands, make light work. And before we kick out, let's give Judd and Joe, and is Aaron still here? And Rob and Jared hands for... Thank you all for the effort and expenditure and everything you do.
Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video presentation. If you did, please subscribe to my YouTube channel, like the video, and share it on your favorite social media sites. There's a lot more to come, so stay tuned, and we'll see you back next time.